Hi, I'm Rachel Barton Pine, and welcome to the second to last episode of Family Fridays with RBP. Today, we're going to be focusing on some of the most fun music that violinists get to play, works inspired by the traditional music of the Roma people, what we refer to as gypsy fiddling. I'll talk about that a little more in a minute, but first, I'm going to kick things off with a shortened version of John Corigliano's Red Violin Caprices. Now, unfortunately, The Red Violin is an R-rated movie, so you have to wait till you're a little bit older to watch it if you're under 17, but it's an amazing film because the main character is not any of the humans in the plot, it's actually the violin. This violin was made in the 1600s by a fictional luthier named Busati, if I recall correctly, and it traces its history from being played by kids in an orphanage in Italy to a child prodigy in Vienna to it went to the group of gypsies and then to a virtuoso from England and then ultimately found its way to China and ended up at auction in Montreal all the way into the 20th century. So it's an amazing journey, passes through a lot of different music history. The composer John Corigliano did a brilliant job with the soundtrack because every time the violin is played in different countries and different centuries, all of the music played on it is actually variations on its original theme, sung by the wife, the pregnant wife of the maker of the violin in the 1600s. Well, I won't give away the whole plot, but in any case, what I am going to play for you right now is the theme, the Red Violin theme, not the iteration of the Red Violin theme, not the version used in the actual Red Violin Caprices, but actually the one from the Red Violin Chaconne, which I play most often and really love. And then I'm going to jump right over the first couple of caprices to the Gypsy Caprice, and then from there to the final caprice. So here is a shortened version of John Corigliano's The Red Violin Caprices. Thank you. last two red violin caprices by John Corigliano. Well, we should talk for a minute about language. Language is so important, especially these days. We're realizing more and more how important it is. I mean, the Washington football team just finally agreed to change their name after all. And so what do we do about this genre of music? I remember when I was a teenager, the moment that I found out that the word GYP that I had been ignorantly using as a synonym for cheat, thinking it was just a random syllable, was actually an ethnic slur against a group of people. I was rather horrified and instantly dropped it from my vocabulary, but I didn't realize until a few years ago that the word for gypsies itself is actually very problematic. It was a group of teenagers who brought that to my attention. I forget what city in the U.S. I was in that week, but I was playing an outreach concert at a local school in advance of a symphony performance. And after my presentation, a couple of kids came up to me and said that they wanted to make sure that I was aware that that really wasn't a word that we should be using these days. And well, I had not heard about this before and Googled it, and sure enough, that they were indeed accurate. And so, you know, what do we do? Of course, you know, we can simply change gypsy fiddling to Roma fiddling, but maybe people might not know what that means. So maybe a halfway approach temporarily. Traditional music of the Roma people, what we have usually called gypsy fiddling in the past, something like that until it sticks. The classical music world and, you know, the violin world, the music world in general, has definitely been grappling with various issues, including issues of language. But I don't recall yet having seen this adequately addressed. Of course, there's often not agreement. For example, most people of color currently embrace the term people of color, but I have one African-American friend who very much dislikes this term, and his arguments are rather persuasive, but I think the best that we can do is go with what's generally considered to be best practices, and I definitely look forward to doing that once that's sort of determined as regards what we've always called a gypsy fiddling. It even becomes problematic in the titles of works. Of course, history is a different category than what we do moving forward, but even European language words like all the derivations of Tzigane and Tzigoiner are apparently just as offensive as the word gypsy, and they're all over our favorite repertoire. So it's not an easy issue, but it's definitely something that we should be aware of. Kids are always on the leading edge. I remember my daughter explaining to me how the Native Americans of the North are the Inuits and we should not use the E word. It's possible to change, and I look forward to this issue being resolved, at least, you know, for whatever we can best do currently. In the jazz world, there's even a whole subgenre called gypsy jazz. I don't know how my jazz colleagues are planning to address that. But again, something that needs to be discussed. So anyway, the next piece I'm going to play is titled Tzigane. It's by the French impressionistic composer Maurice Ravel. And I think part of what makes this piece so enduringly popular is the fact that he blends this wonderful fiddly style, using his own original melodies, with his brilliant approach to orchestration. But of course, the entire first half of this piece is for solo violin, kind of, you know, thinking of just one violin by the campfire, or more in more modern times, perhaps, you know, in a restaurant where you might encounter this kind of fiddling. And so then the whole orchestra comes in and it's just amazing. So I'm gonna play just the unaccompanied portion since I don't have an orchestra here in my living room. Actually, when you think about it, can you think of any other piece for violin and orchestra where the whole first half of the piece is unaccompanied? I mean, Prokofiev Concerto No. 2 starts with the violin unaccompanied for a few measures, which is unusual enough. The Mat Selvage, what is it called? That great poem concertant or something like that? I recorded it on a Mat Selvage album a few years back. That piece has a very long extended cadenza, but the orchestra does play before that cadenza begins. So that's the closest equivalent I've yet encountered. Anyhow, the whole first page of the two pages of this cadenza is entirely on the G string, which is really, really cool, kind of a Paganini trick, but using it, I think, more for the color of that string, and getting that really deep sound even way up high on the instrument. Then, of course, it goes to the four strings with all kinds of double stops and everything else. So here is the opening section of Maurice Ravel's Tzigane. Comes in. Well, if you want to hear me play the rest of Tzigane, I actually do have a concert with orchestra on my YouTube channel. But there you go. There's the cadenza, and I think I need to change my shoulder bar. I think this one has reached its expiration date. Anyway, okay, so that was a French composer, what you might call an impression of Roma fiddling. I love fusion music, and in that case, of course, the fiddle style blended with French impressionism. Now I'm going to finish off with a work by a Spanish composer, and no, it's not Sarasate's Tzigane Reisen, though I know that's a beloved favorite. I do actually have that one on my YouTube channel as well, if you want to hear me play it. But I think we're so used to hearing that one with accompaniment, it might be a little weird to hear it played a cappella. So instead I'm going to play what's actually my very favorite. I love this one even more than Monti's Chardash. I just think it's so clever and so physically fun to play and awesome to listen to. This is a piece by a composer named Cesar Espejo. So I had been looking for him for years in every English language dictionary, every Spanish language dictionary. You know, sometimes you can find stuff that isn't in current prints. Well, now it's all online, but even so, sometimes you could find stuff in older editions, you know, the edition from 1912 or something like that of a dictionary, and there'll be information in there that never survived into later versions. So I was looking for Espejo everywhere, and it turned out that the reason I wasn't finding him is that he had made his entire career in France, but he still definitely retained his Spanish identity, and actually his brilliant unaccompanied work, Prelude Iberique, is on my Capriccio Latino album, and it was thanks to the program note writer, the wonderful scholar Ilbiu Barilari, that I finally found out what was up with this Espejo guy. Well, first let me tell you how I came across this music. Like, how did I find this piece if I'd never heard of the composer? Well, a number of years back, maybe 15 years ago or something, I was playing a recital, I think it was in Florida. And afterwards, a woman came up to me and said that she could tell by my program that I liked overlooked repertoire as well as famous repertoire, and that her father had a collection of music that he wanted to pass along to someone while he was still alive to have the pleasure of doing so. His name was Isidore Zinman, and he lived in Pittsburgh. I wasn't touring through Pennsylvania anytime that particular season, but we managed to route ourselves that way when we were going up and down the East Coast. And so I went to Pittsburgh and met Mr. Zinman. He was 97 years old, still practiced the violin every day, and played in his local Jewish Community Center Symphony Orchestra. Such an amazing inspiration. And he gave me a big box of sheet music, much of which was published in the late 18 or early 1900s. Of course, a lot of them were, you know, the usual pieces from the violin repertoire, but then there were a number of pieces that I'd never heard of that piece or I'd never heard of that composer, stuff that had been long since out of print. And this Airs Tziganes by Cesar Espejo was there in that stack, and it's turned out to be one of my all-time favorite pieces. In fact, these days, normally you would go to IMSLP to find music, but there's still a real value to getting a stack of old music from someone because, first of all, if you've never heard of the guy, you wouldn't know to Google him. And second of all, not everything is on IMSLP. And in fact, this piece is apparently still not on IMSLP. I checked this morning. So if you hear me play it and want to play it yourself, there is a way to get the music. And I would recommend that you go to episode 2 of my old Violin Adventures podcast, which is literally titled How to Find Out of Print Sheet Music. Of course, I made that episode long before IMSLP existed, but there are still pieces that aren't on there, so it's still relevant. And if you follow the steps laid out in the podcast, you can get your hands on the sheet music for this amazing piece. It was recorded once, I believe, by Misha Elman back in the 50s. And I actually did hear Perlman perform it once, so I'm not the only person who's discovered it. It's a really cool piece. Gosh, well, it follows the form that you're familiar with from Monti's Chardash. So it has the wild improvisatory section, which is very emotional and constantly surprising you at every twist and turn, very rhythmically unmetered to a certain extent, or what we call rubato, where of course the rhythm is written on the page, but you push and pull it all over the place. And then you launch into a very metronomic, crazy, fiddly, fast section. And then there's a more stately, but still rhythmic section, usually a soft part and a loud part and a soft part, and then you get back into the final fast section, which in some pieces kicks right in loud or kicks right in fast, and in other pieces, like the way I interpret this one, kind of creeps back in with a gradual rising of the tempo. And basically, this is a very typical form for this kind of music. And I was very lucky that one of my professors, Roland Vamos, in his younger years, used to actually do what he called in those days plays gypsy fiddling in Hungarian restaurants as some of his student days freelance gigs. And that's another thing I'll just briefly mention is a lot of times we conflate music of the Roma people who were living in Hungary with Hungarian music, which of course you could say they're Hungarians, are living in Hungary, but they're not of Hungarian ethnic descent. And all of those Brahms Hungarian dances and Joachim Hungarian concerto and Hungarian rhapsodies of Franz Liszt, all of that stuff is actually the music of the Roma people. And you'll see it often following this form of the rubato and the fast and the slow and stately and then the accelerando and all of that. And of course you can hear the ethnic music of Hungarians translated to the classical idiom in works by guys like Kodály and Bartók. But anyway, here is the interpretation of this wonderful fiddle style by a Spanish composer living in France. I don't know enough about all the traditional melodies to know if these melodies are in fact traditional ones. I know that the ones used in Sardis and the ones used in Zigeunerweisen are not composed by Monti or Sarasate. They are traditional tunes made into a classical version by those guys. And of course, all the Liszt and Brahms stuff were not their original melodies either. I'm not sure about this piece. I suspect it might be not Espejo's original melodies, but what he did with it, as you will see, is pretty darn cool.
Thank you.
Tziganes by Cesar Espejo. Well, that wraps up our second to last episode of Family Fridays with RBP. Thank you so much for joining me all these weeks and months. Next week is Christmas Day, and it will be the final episode. I'll be joined by my family. We'll be doing a little bit of the Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens, the scene with Fezziwig's fiddler, of course, playing the very tune that was played in the book. We'll be doing excerpts from A Mall and the Night Visitors, from Handel's Messiah, Corelli's Christmas Concerto, lots of different carols. Should be really fun. I asked my family, do you guys want to, you know, stay in your pajamas and sleep in or do a concert with me? And they said, oh, we want to do a concert. So I've definitely got a great family, and I hope that you and your family will join us. And then after the new year, I've got some new projects that I hope you'll check out. I'm going to be doing a masterclass series of all of the Bach sonatas and partitas. And I'm going to be launching a weekly concertos concert starting Sunday afternoon, January 3, and going for 24 weeks, 24 different concertos in 24 weeks. I'll definitely have a lot of practicing to do, but it should be really enjoyable to share those together. So I hope you have a great holiday season, and I'll see you next week.